This
सेमिनार
conference
नेशनल
will now be
कॉन्फ्रेंस
recorded.
पास्ट कन्वीनर ऑफ घाटकोपर सीपी स्टडी सर्कल कोऑर्डिनेटिंग मेंबर ऑन डिफरेंट कमिटी ऑफ प्रोफेशनल ऑर्गेनाइजेशन कोऑर्डिनेटर ऑफ फॉर आईटी सपोर्ट फॉर बैंक ऑडिट क्वेरीज पोर्टल इंस्टीट्यूट बाय आईसीएआई फॉर पास्ट 7 इयर्स एक्टिंग एज अ पीयर रिव्यू ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ आईसीएआई एज अ पैनल मेंबर. दिस इज अ फॉर्मल इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ सीए मेहुल सर. Other than this, I also want to introduce Mehul sir as not only the expert in Companies Act and the Income Tax Act, but he is also a good motivator guru for keeping good health and positive thinking. In this situation where we all are in, he is the one who is keeping his near and dear ones motivated for doing yoga and for keeping positive thinking throughout this situation. With this introduction, I hand over to the Mehul sir for starting the session. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mamta, for your kind words. In fact, the spirituality and yoga and all are actually something very, very personal. Could have been shared somewhere else rather than on this forum. Meet as maybe. Thank you, Charvik and Bhavin Bhai too, Ramesh Bhai Pokar also, other coordinators and my seniors in profession and my dear friends. It's in fact a great opportunity and always a learning exercise when I'm speaking before Ghatkopar Study Circle. In fact, this is not Ghatkopar Study Circle, I know, but it's a learning session for all of us. See, Ghatkopar Study Circle has actually gone into my blood. That's the reason I'm extremely sorry for that. Any which ways. Charvik, can we have Charvik?
Yes, sir. Wait a second. Yes, sir. Wait a second. Will do.
Okay, thank you, Charvik.
It is from Ganesh Patidar. Ganesh, can you please mute your mic?
Yeah, thank you. So the topic that we have selected for this ninth learning session is provisions of company law concerning audit. So basically, the company audit has always been a dear topic, and in fact, not only company audit, but I would say company law per se, because I started my career as a company law consultant initially in 1995, and that's how this journey in fact started. And it's been almost 25 years now I've been studying Companies Act. Post 2013 Act, this Act actually made me illiterate to an extent, because 1956 Act, if you ask me any section, and I was able to actually verbatimly tell you exactly what is the provision. That is not the case with 2013 Act. But now this kind of meeting is enabling me to brush up my knowledge, actually understand, recap, I would say, as to how do I go further in this practice. So to some extent, this is going to be a kind of refresher course for all of us, because we all have been doing company audit for past so many donkey number of years, I would say. There are so many seniors like Nalin Bhai, Amit Bhai, who have been practicing in this area right from 1973, Nalin Bhai, Amit Bhai 1985, and so many other seniors are also there. But things keep on changing, and we need to refresh our knowledge. At the same time, there are certain new things also which come up. So we'll be trying to understand all those things. Typically, the scope of this presentation is going to be this way, that I'll be dealing with the provisions of Companies Act that are actually concerning our audit practice. And that's how it's going to be. I'm discussing incorporation provisions of that kind of a thing. Okay. So the scope of this presentation is per se with respect to either doing audit or concerning audit. This is how one should actually understand this. These are my favorite slides, but you all know, so I'll just skip those slides. So the scope of presentation this time is I'll be dealing with certain very, very important definitions. Account of companies, audit of audit and auditors, section 139, 139. Other important sections concerning audit, requirements, reporting requirements under CARO 2016. By the way, CARO 2020, you all know, has been deferred. So we'll be dealing with CARO 2016, but I'm not dealing with the process per se of CARO. I am told by Charvik that that meeting is going to be scheduled separately. So CARO provisions, those clauses 1 to 16 are not going to be dealt with by me. But certain important aspects of CARO as to whether CARO would be applicable in this case or not, that we'll be discussing. And documentation way forward, which also there is part of the presentation, but let's see how much time are we having. So the definitions. First definition that I am dealing with is small company. My father is also accompanying me, so I'll just exemption to small company. See, basically, why do we need to understand the small companies? There's a reason for that. Small companies have been given certain exemptions under the company law with respect to maintenance of books of account, but I would say making cash flow statement and complying with certain accounting standards, etc. So let us understand this definition first. Exemption, this 240 is the financial statement, then we'll be going to 285, that is small companies. 240 is financial statement, which says that financial statement means a balance sheet, profit and loss account, cash flow statement for a financial year, statement of changes in equity, and explanatory note annex thereto. All right. And provided that financial statements with respect to one person company, small company, and dormant company may not include cash flow statements. So typically, what's happening is that in case if you are a small company within the meaning of Section 285, which we are dealing with separately, then you don't have to give cash flow statement. This is what the sum and substance of this financial statement definition is. Okay. Now, if you refer to AS3, there is an anomaly. I'm not dealing with AS3 right now, but that needs to be corrected. I've been telling this, but somehow it has not reached to the right the right forum. But if you consider AS3, then probably to small companies also it would apply. This is how it is, but I'm not going into those details right now. Let us skip that part. Okay, so just understand that in case if you are a small company, then cash flow statement is not to be given, otherwise cash flow statement needs to be given by everybody. Now we go to Section 285 of the Companies Act, which says that small company means a company other than a public company. So if you are a public company, then you are not a small company, however, whatever size you are. Okay. Whose paid up capital does not exceed 50 lakh rupees, but government has acquired the powers that even if you are 10 crore company, capital company, then also they may notify that this will not be treated as a small company, but as of today that notification is not. So you remain a small company only if your paid up capital does not exceed 50 lakh rupees and turnover which as per profit and loss account for immediately preceding previous financial year does not exceed 2 crore rupees, okay, and which could go to 100 crore rupees in case if the government notifies. But at this point in time, rupees 10 crore and rupees 100 crore we park at a separate place for the simple reason that they will not be notified. As of today, if your paid up capital is not exceeding 50 lakh rupees and turnover does not exceed 2 crore rupees, then you are a small company. So if one of the conditions is violated, no, I would say violated, but it's not satisfied. Let's say your capital is more than 50 lakh rupees or your turnover is more than 2 crore rupees, as the case may be. If one of the conditions is not satisfied, then you cease to be a small company. And once you cease to be a small company, immediately cash flow statement will come in play, CARO will come in play probably. And at the same time, probably other accounting standards may also come into play. This is how one should actually read this. So, provided that nothing in disclosure shall apply to a holding company or a subsidiary company. So, even if you are a company having capital less than 50 lakh and a turnover of less than 2 crore, but if you are a holding company of another company or a subsidiary of another company, okay, or if you are a company registered under Section 8, that is Section 25 Companies of 1956, right? Or a company or a body corporate governed by a special act like Electricity Act or Insurance Company Act, as the case may be, in that case, you will not be treated as a small company. So mind you, this particular thing is section 8 companies, that is section 24 companies, irrespective of its size and nature, will have to give cash flow statement. This is what one should understand, because it is not a small company. Correct? So I will just narrate this. It should not be a small company. Its paid up capital should be 50 lakh rupees or less. Turnover should be 2 crore rupees or less. It should not be holding subsidiary relationship. Section 8 company, it should not be Section 8 company. In case if it is Section 8 company, it does not become a small company. A company formed under the Special Act is also out of this. Okay. Then we go to next definition of turnover, section 291. Now 291, old definition has been amended by the new definition. Earlier definition was that turnover means aggregate value of realization of amount made from sales, supply or distribution of goods. So what is to happen is, let's say my turnover, my sale per se is, let's say, 2 crore rupees. Out of 2 crore rupees, let's say my debtors, every debtors are 60 lakh rupees. So what I actually realize is 1 crore 40 lakh rupees. Okay. In that case, my turnover would be regarded as only 1.40 crore and not 1 or 2 crore rupees. Okay. So all these years, we have always been carrying an impression that whatever turnover is there in the profit and loss account, or sale which is there in profit and loss account, constitutes my turnover is not, was not the writing earlier. Okay. Now that particular position has been changed to the new definition, and now on the right hand side of you, you will find that new definition says that turnover means the gross amount of revenue recognized in profit and loss account from sale, supply or distribution of goods on account of services rendered or both. So now the anomaly which was there has been removed, and whatever is reported by you in profit and loss account constitutes your turnover. This is how now you should be understanding. So total revenue disclosed as in Schedule 3 to the Companies Act, other income also would be considered as part of your revenue, and revenue from discontinuing operation, in case if you have, will also have to be considered for this purpose. Then another important definition is free reserve. In fact, when we are asked to find out the free reserve, we will just pick up the amount which is there in our liability set, the reserves and surplus set. But once you refer to this definition, your concept will change. I'll just read out this definition. Such reserves which, as per the latest audited balance sheets, are available for distribution of dividend, provided that, be careful on this, any amount representing unrealized gains, notional gains or revaluation of assets, whether shown as reserve or otherwise. Okay. That means, let's say you are following accounting standard 11. Okay, and there is foreign currency fluctuation reserve which is created for on the debtors or creditor, as the case may be. Okay, and that particular gain is unrealized. Let's say that gain, your total profit for the current year is, let's say, 10 lakh rupees. Out of the 10 lakh rupees, 1 lakh rupees is unrealized gain on account of foreign exchange. Okay, then your actual profit that should be considered as your free reserve should not be 10 lakh but 9 lakh rupees. Okay, this is the thing, any amount representing unrealized gains, notional gains or revaluation. Of course, revaluation reserve, we all know that in case if revaluation reserve is there, it does not form part of my free reserve. But unrealized gain is a thing which actually nobody paid attention to this aspect, and this is what one needs to be careful about. And or any change in carrying amount of asset or liability recognized in equity, including surplus in P&L or measurement of asset or liability at fair value. So let's say you are making a fair valuation of your balance sheet, you are making revaluation as the case may be. Okay, or maybe you are under Ind AS as the case may be. All those things, whatever is actually not earned but only fair valued by you in the balance sheet, will not be treated as a free reserve. So typically, free reserve should be considered as that reserve which is available to you for declaration of dividends. This is how one should understand. So I have written that unreal implication of unrealized gains, adjustment for receivables under AS 11 restatement, etc., which needs to be careful. You need to be careful. Another definition which is there is associate company under section 26. associate company in relation to another. I have no option but to read this definition out, because each word probably is important to us. But then we'll be going a little fast. Associate company in relation to another company means a company in which that other company has significant influence, but which is not a subsidiary company of the company having such influence, and includes joint venture company. Now, why this definition is important will come to come at a later stage as to why this is important. But associate company means what is significant influence is, in case if I am holding share capital of another company more than 20%, okay, or I have voting power. If I have voting power of another company at of more than 20%, as the case may be, then that particular company becomes my associate company. Okay, and why I'm just telling you why this definition is important is, when we come to consolidation of account under section 129, at that point in time you would find that for consolidation purposes even associate company needs to be considered, and associate company also includes joint venture. Okay, so joint venture means a joint arrangement whereby the parties that have joint control of the arrangement have rights to a right to the net assets of the arrangement. Okay, so typically either you are one is subsidiary company which is governed by AS 21, then you have associate company which is governed by AS 23, and another is joint venture that is governed by AS 27, which will be covering at a later stage. But associate company, you need to understand that in case if I have significant influence by holding not less than 20% share capital of another company, then it is an associate company. Subsidiary company, we all know, is that in case if I am holding it's a long definition, but I'll just explain that in case if I am holding not less than 50% I would say of share capital of another company, then that particular company becomes my subsidiary. Okay, or if I am able to exercise control over composition of the board of directors, in the sense that, let's say my employee, I have a group of companies, okay, and I don't want to be part of that company for any XYZ reason. Okay, so what I'm doing is, my flagship company is XYZ and there is another company ABC. Now, employee of XYZ is my director, or employees rather, than there are two employees of XYZ which I'm owning, or I'm controlling. Those employees are becoming directors of ABC. Okay, in that case, technically that ABC is my subsidiary, because ultimately I am at liberty to remove those directors any point.
So if I, Mirabai, sorry to disturb you. There is some disturbance, yeah, in your voice.
My voice?
Yeah, your voice.
I'll just give me a minute, please.
Maybe fan issue.
Yeah, Charvik, now I think it should be clear.
Yeah, is it is better.
Okay.
Yes, yes.
Great. Okay, fine. So subsidiary I was talking about is basically that in case if I'm holding not less than 50%, more than I would say 50% of share capital of another company, or if I'm controlling composition of board of directors of that company. As I gave the example, my employees are actually employees there, are directors there. Then naturally, if I set those employees out, then I can actually control that company. Then also that company becomes my subsidiary because of this definition. Okay. So these are the two things. And under accounting standard 21 consolidation, in either of the situations, whether I am actually controlling more than 50% capital or I am controlling composition of board of directors, consolidation needs to be done. Okay, so this is how one should actually understand subsidiary company. Then next is books of books, and then we'll go to books of account. Section 212, books and paper, and or books or paper include books of account, deeds, vouchers, writing documents, minutes, registers maintained on paper and electronic form. So basically, as and when there is a reference to books and paper, or books or paper as the case may be, it would also include registers under 189 or minutes as the case may be. Okay, now books of account include the, we have always a litigation or maybe there a debate which is going on whether stock register partakes character of my books of account or not. So please read this definition. Books of account includes records maintained in respect of all sums of money received and expended by the company, and matters in relation to which the receipts and expenditure takes place, all sales and purchases of goods and services, assets and liabilities of the company, and items of cost under 148. So basically, when it covers my assets and liabilities, stock per se is nothing but my asset. Okay, accordingly, even a stock register partakes character of books of account according to me, and you should actually be careful on this. And in case if you have not maintained stock register for any reason for a company, then as an auditor, it is our responsibility to qualify the report that proper books of account are not maintained. This is how it is important. Section 216 is charge, means any interest in lien, interest or lien created on the property of asset of a company. Earlier section 125 of 1956 Act. Now be careful that 1956 Act was not covering pledge. Okay. So in case if I just handed over the security in hands of the lender, then that particular charge was not to be registered. But under the new law, whether it is mortgage or hypothecation or pledge or even lien, all these charges which are created by you have to be registered with the ROC. This is what it is. Okay. Another issue that comes up is motor car which is purchased in the name of director. Okay. The loan document is in name of the director only. Maybe you may have company's name also, but basically the loan is given to the person who buys the motor car. And why we do so? Because in order to save on the road tax. Okay, it's all together a different thing that whether depreciation is admissible under the income tax act or not. That litigation is separate. I'm not onto that litigation. But when it comes to Companies Act, if an asset is not held in name of the company, then a disclosure is required somewhere that motor car is not held in, or a particular asset is not held in the name of company. Okay, this is what is very important to be noted. Okay, and one more thing is, now how do we register this charge? Okay, because see, technically the loan is not in the name of company, but loan is in the name of director. Why? Because the car is in name of the director. So technically I would say that this kind of a loan should not be treated as a secured loan, but should be treated as an unsecured loan. But yes, there is a debate, there is a difference of opinion on this. And in fact, I would just share with you, I'm part of the study group of the institutes, one of the committees, corporate law committee, where we are writing a book on this charge. Okay, a small publication, and that publication is supposed to be out by May or so. Okay, and there we had a debate, and even there we also could not conclude whether this kind of a case, the loan should be treated as secured or unsecured. But to me, it appears that this kind of an agreement cannot be registered as a charge with the ROC because it is not in the name of company. Accordingly, if it is not in name of the company, the more that this loan will have to be treated as unsecured and not secured. Okay, another thing is personal loans to the Haji.
Sir, sorry to interrupt, can I ask a question, small one?
Yes sir.
This is Rajiv Lutia. Sir, the when the loan is taken of director itself, can you say that it is a liability of company and can you take it in the books of account itself first of all?
Rajiv bhai, see, I'll tell you the issue here is that beneficial ownership lies with the company. Okay. The directors, if you don't bring it to the company, then the problem would be that you would not be able to claim depreciation, and the directors want both the benefits. They want to pay less road tax. At the same time, they want to claim depreciation. This is the typical issue with private limited companies. Public companies, this is not the issue, I know. Okay. So in case if you don't want to bring this asset into the books of account, then it is fine, fantastic. But if you want to bring this asset in the books of account, okay, and the loan statement, loans, the loan documents are in the name of director, can you classify this loan as a secured loan is the main issue. Now it's altogether a different thing that the bank will still exercise its powers to take the asset back in case if you don't pay. Okay, but as I said earlier, that it is, I am not able to conclude, even the committee could not conclude as to what should be there. Because typically all these years, see, there is one section, earlier section 49 under the Companies Act 1956, 2013 Act, I missed on that section right now. But there is a provision that if the investments are held in name of a person other than company, then there is a disclosure required. Okay, if that is the case, now that is only with respect to investment. But with respect to fixed assets, there is always a presumption that the assets are there in name of company. Now, if you refer to Caro also had one of the points for fixed assets, that whether title deeds are registered in the name of company or not. We were to report that. Okay, but that kind of a thing, it is with respect to immovable property. With respect to movable property, even Caro is silent, right? So with due respect, I am not able to conclude what should be done, but my reading is this way, that in case a charge is not capable of being created or registered, I would say, not created is a different thing, registered is a different thing. But when the loan document is not in the name of company, can you really go to ROC and register the charge? And if you don't register the charge, can you treat this particular loan as a secured loan is my question. But we have a huge portion to left. If you don't mind, Rajiv bhai, we can discuss this at a later time. And I go ahead. Even personal loans to professional heading companies also, this is also another thing. Okay, the banks are giving personal loans to the company, to the direct, let's say doctors are there. Typically, this is the issue with doctors who are means nursing homes or clinics who are practicing as private companies. They take personal loans. Now, the surprising part of it is the loan is in name of the director, but you will find that the check will come in the name of in company. The installments will be given by the company. Okay, now whether it is legal, illegal is, I'm not on that issue, please. Okay, the issue here is that in case if this kind of a situation is there, how do you classify this particular loan? Even this kind of a loan will have to be treated as unsecured loan for the simple reason that such personal loans are given as actually backed up by the personal guarantees of directors. Okay, accordingly, such loans would be treated as unsecured loans. Okay, this is what one should understand. Next is net worth. Okay, so net worth means aggregate value of paid up share capital and reserves created out of profits, securities premium and debit balance or credit balance. So earlier we had one thing which was free reserve. Okay, and now we are dealing with net worth, means aggregate value of paid up capital and all reserves out of profits, securities premium, debit and credit balance of P&L account. After deducting the aggregate amount of accumulated losses, deferred expenditure and miscellaneous expenses, okay, but does not include revaluation reserve and write backs and depreciation, etc. Okay, so net worth, as we simply understand, is basically the amount that of share capital plus security premium plus free reserves. Okay, but in case if there are some accumulated losses or deferred revenue expenses, which are deferred expenses or miscellaneous expenses, of course now business expenditure is already taken out of the because of the accounting standard 26, if I'm not mistaken. But be it as maybe, other deferred expenses will have to be taken out of the net worth for this purpose. So if there is a deferred tax asset that cannot form part of your net worth, you will have to reduce while calculating the net worth. Okay. I'm just, the deferred tax asset is one of the examples. There could be any others also. Okay. And revaluation reserve will have to be taken out of it. Then another definition is relative, means section 2K77. If you are members of HUF, your husband or wife, okay, or one person is related to another another in the manner prescribed, and which is that is in case father including stepfather, mother including stepmother, son including stepson, son's wife, daughter, daughter's husband, brother including stepbrother, and sister including stepsister. The sister including stepsister. So these are the only people now. Earlier, section 6 of the Companies Act 1956, schedule 1A, there was a long list. Now that list has been curtailed, and only these people are treated as relatives of each other, and accordingly the provisions of Companies Act will have to be construed. So now we are through with the definition part, and now I move on to the main chapters. Now we'll be dealing with accounts of companies and audits and auditors, etc. And then we'll be dealing with certain other sections also. 128 deals with books of account. I'm dealing with these sections in a little more detail at a later stage. So 128 is books of account, etc., to be kept by the company. 129 deals with financial statements. 130 is dealing with reopening of accounts. 131 is voluntary revision of financial statements. 132, constitution of National Financial Reporting Authority, that is NAFTA. 133 is central government to prescribe accounting standards. 134 is financial statements, board report, etc. 135, corporate social responsibility, CSR. And 136 is right of members to copies of audited financial statements. 137, copy of financial statements to be filed with the registrar. And 138 is internal audit. Whether we read entire Companies Act or not is not of consequence, I would say. But in case if I'm doing company audit, in that case, it is necessary for me to read 129 to 138 sections. Very important. Same way, 139 to 148 section. So typically 129 to 148, I repeat, 129, section 129 to section 148 are Bible, I would say, to the company audit. Unless and until we know all these sections well, it is very difficult for us to actually do company audit effectively. We will be able to do it, do company audit, no worries about it. Okay. But there is always an inherent risk that we are taking in that case if you don't know these sections. So section 128 deals with preparation. What it says is a company should prepare and keep its books of account at its registered office and other relevant papers for every financial year. And the account should give true and fair view, including that of branch office, and the books of account should be on accrual basis. This fundamental we all know. Okay, no worries about it. Now next is that books of account can be kept at other place also. Now we often have this kind of an issue that registered office is kept at one place and the books of account are often kept at some other place. Maybe the director's residence is treated as registered office for XYZ reason, and the office has the books of account. Technically, I would say you should go to ROC, and within 7 days from the date on which you are keeping these books of account, you should intimate the ROC that although my registered office is at XYZ address, but my books of account are at ABC address. Now, you will say, why should I be doing? Yes, you should not be doing, fine. You may not do it, fine. Okay. But technically, in case if there is any inspection, like income tax mein hamare udhar survey aata hai. Meantime, I forgot to ask our friend Rajesh Dolu had asked me ki Mehul bhai ye meeting Hindi mein lena. Main bola, maine bola tha usko, main jitna ho sakta hai utna Hindi mein lunga. Lekin I forgot that, Raju, I'm sorry about it. but the flow is this way that speaking in Hindi would be a little difficult thing. But yes, as and when it is possible, I'll speak something in Hindi in order to please my friend Rajesh Tolu. Okay. So let us say कि जैसे income tax 133 का survey आता है, the survey can take place only at the business premises. Okay. The same way ROC now has power के आपके उधर आ सकते हैं and they can survey you. Not typically survey you from income tax angle, but they have powers to investigate or inspect as the case may be. And at that point in time, if they come to the registered office and they find that the books of account are not there, you can be in for a trouble because of penalties could be there. And penalties are very heavy, very, very heavy. So be careful on that. Okay. And the books of account can also be kept in electronic mode and they have to be preserved for 8 financial years. Under income tax act, we have 6 financial years. But here we should be keeping the books of account for 8 financial years immediately the preceding financial year. Now section 129 deals with financial statements. Financial statements shall give true and fair view of the state of affairs and they should comply with the accounting standard notified under 133 and they should be in the format of schedule 3. So we would just go to the earlier slide where we had financial statements, balance sheet, profit and loss account, cash flow statement, statement of changes in equity if applicable. Now changes in equity, by the way, is to be given only by the listed companies, not by unlisted companies. So you otherwise don't have to worry about it. And explanatory note annexed there too. These are the things called as financial statements and they have to be complying with section 133 of the Companies Act and that is accounting standards. And they should be in the format of Schedule 3. Now, one more thing which I would suggest is Schedule 3. I often find balance sheets very in certain irrelevant, I would not say irrelevant, but not applicable lines are deleted. Let's say I have long-term liabilities or current liabilities. Under long-term liabilities or current liabilities, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 lines. Okay. Now let us take inventories and sundry debtors. Okay. Now the company does not have inventory also, company does not have sundry debtors also. Okay, then what happens is the company or the chartered accountant is the case, maybe they delete that particular line out of the balance sheet, okay, to make the balance sheet small. Okay, technically this is not permissible. If your inventory is zero, then you should put zero instead of deleting the line. This is what my reading is. Still, you can have your own view and decide about it. Okay. Provided that items contained in such financial statement shall be in accordance with accounting standards. So earlier somebody was asking me that how is it the case that accounting standards override the provisions of Companies Act? Now, if you refer to the accounting standards of institute is very clear, then in case if the accounting standards are not in compliance with the law of the land, then law of the land will prevail over the accounting standard. That is the mandate of institute. Okay, right. Now, contrary to this, Companies Act 2013 and 1956 earlier also are very clear stating that in case if something is there in accounting standard which is not in conformity with the law, then it is the accounting standard which will prevail and not the company law. Okay, so wherever you find some difference out, then it is the accounting standard that prevails over the normal company law, which you should be keeping in mind. Now the financial statements have to be placed before the AGM, and as I said, you need to consolidate in case if you are a subsidiary. For subsidiary, the accounting standard 21 is applicable. For associate, consolidation accounting standard 23 is applicable, and for joint venture it is AS 27 that is applicable. And a separate statement containing the salient features of financial statements of subsidiary is also to be given in form AOC 1, as may be prescribed likha hai udhar. Okay, that prescribed form is AOC1. I've seen most of the companies are not giving any details of AOC1, but technically, yes, AOC1 needs to be given in the financial statements as an attached document. Okay. And in case if there is any deviation from the accounting standard, okay, in that case, the company has to quantify the effect and reasons in the director's report. Let us say accounting standard 2 is not followed. or maybe other standard is not followed as the case may be for any reason, okay, in that case the company has to state that yes, I have not followed this particular accounting standard and this is the reason. And not only this, auditor will have to qualify the report because the accounting standard has not been followed. Okay. Then section 131 deals with voluntary revision. I'll very quickly run through this. Is that in case if the company feels, the directors feel that the financial statements of the company or the board or the report of board are not in compliance with section 129 or 134, they can go for voluntary revision by making an application to the tribunal, and the tribunal in that case will give notice to the ROC and the income tax authority. Okay, and this revision can take place only once in a financial year. But why this is very important is that, see, ultimately if there is a revision taking place, our role as a chartered accountant can also be questioned tomorrow by the tribunal as to why did you certify this or why did you sign this. So be careful on this aspect, please. 133 deals with accounting standard, and this accounting, so government has notified accounting standards. Now by and large all those accounting standards are of the institute only, with some of the other changes. An institute then has made changes in its accounting standards as per the ministry standards. So by and large the ministry standards and the institute standards are at par, barring certain differences. We are not going to the differences right now, but be it as may be, accounting standards for the companies are to be complied with of ministry only. This is what needs to be considered and kept in mind. Okay. So the fundamentals of accounting standards and others are the standards of ICAI, standards of MCA, guidance note of ICAI, standards on auditing, SAs. Okay. So ICAI also has the similar set of accounting standards, which are now applicable only to non-corporates, including LLPs. Okay. MCA standards are applicable to only companies, to my mind, not to MR, to LLPs. There is a view that the ministry standard should be applied to the MCA, to LLPs, but I have a difference of opinion, but let's keep that point as it is right now. Okay, accounting standard of institute, to my mind, should be applied. Otherwise, guidance note of institute are again mandatory, and essays are again mandatory. There is a I'm coming to the SAS part at a later moment. So we had accounting standard rules 2006, were dated December 7, 2006, and now then we have Ind AS, then we have ICDS also, which are applicable across the board to everybody but on computation. Okay, and we have level 1, level 2, level 3 enterprises of the institute. Which is level 1, I'm coming to that level, means then I will explain. Level 1 basically is listed or proposed to be listed banks, FIs, enterprises with a turnover more than 50 crore or borrowing more than 10 crore or holding subsidiary companies. Level 2 enterprises are more than 1 crore turnover but less than 50 crore, more than 1 crore borrowing but less than 10 crore borrowing, or holding or subsidiary companies of any of these companies. And level 3 are other companies. Why this definition is important is to understand that if you are a level 1 enterprise, all mandatory accounting standards are applicable to you, including AS3, AS17, that is segment, AS19, that is lease. Okay, all standards are across the board applicable to level 1 enterprises. Level 2 enterprises, only mandatory accounting standards are applicable. So AS3 per se would not otherwise be applicable. And even otherwise you're a small company, then also it is not applicable. Okay, but in case if you are not a small company, then even if AS3 says that it is not applicable, the law says that it is applicable. And that's where I was telling earlier that AS3 needs to be revised, because technically AS3 says that it will not apply. Okay, so the accounting standard says it will not apply. Law says it will apply. Now which overrides what? Accounting standard overrides the provisions of law. And if that is the case, then even if I am a large company, I still don't give this cash flow statement. This is what the interpretation is all about. It was the reason I did not want to go into that particular controversy, but any which ways, I recollected and told you. Okay, and level 3 enterprises. Now accounting standard rules have made the same categorization, but instead of level 2 enterprises, they have treated them or named them as small and medium sized enterprises. Okay, so small and medium sized companies means companies whose debt or equity are not listed or not about to be listed. That is, they are not banks or financial institutions. So if you refer to this particular thing, level one is basically large enterprise. Level two is small and medium sized enterprise, as simple as that. Okay, so I'm not touching the slides otherwise. Then there is a general instructions for SMCs, small and medium sized companies, which says that in case you are an SMC, you are a small and medium sized company, then you should give this particular disclosure in your notes on account, which says that the company is a small and medium sized company as defined in general instructions in respect of accounting standards notified under Companies Act 2013. Accordingly, the company has complied with the accounting standards as applicable to small and medium sized company. Now let us say this note is not given by you, okay, by the company, not you, this company, okay. In that case, indirectly you are accepting that you are a large enterprise, and if you are a large enterprise, then let us say segment reporting is not given, then you are not given the mandatory accounting standard according to the law. Okay, that's the precise reason that if you are a small and medium sized enterprise, this note should be given as part of the notes on account, so that you are able to say that since I am a small and medium sized enterprise, whatever accounting standards which are not mandatory for me have not been complied by me. This is why, this is how it is. Figures of the corresponding period, okay, this is not very important. Yeah, this is very important. Let us say that you are a small company, so you don't have to give cash flow statement, okay, but the company has some credit line from car bank, and the bankers are insisting that no cash flow statement has to be given, okay, now for any reason, okay. And the director say, okay, sir, cash flow statement bana do, and we are always willing to help our client, so we make this cash flow statement and we sign it also, okay. So a small company complying with a non-mandatory accounting standard, right, once you do this, then you will have to disclose that which other mandatory accounting standards have not been followed by you. In the sense, let us say being a small company, you are not required to follow AS3, that is cash flow statement, and accounting standard 17, that is segment reporting. Now being a small company, you are following cash flow statement, that is AS3, then you will have to write that yes, I have followed AS3, but I have not followed AS17. This is what the law requires us to give. Be careful on this, please. Laws to override accounting standards as far as institute is concerned, but as far as Companies Act is concerned, accounting standards override the provisions of law. Now, these are the applicable accounting standards which we all know. So I'll rush through the slides. Mandatory 133, Rule 7, accounting standard rules and concessions, as we have already discussed. For non-corporate entities, there are the accounting standard 1 and 2 of the Income Tax Act, and now they're ICDS. We are not dealing with them. Okay. Be careful on this. These are the mandatory accounting and important standards are AS1, AS2, AS4, AS5, AS6 has already gone. It has been merged with AS10, AS7, AS9, AS10, AS13, 16, 18, etc. are mandatory accounting standards across the board. ICDS again 1 to 10 are there. Of course, it is all company audit. So, ये मैंने किसी और presentation से उठा के इधर डाल दिया था तो ICDS आ गया है. Okay. True and fair, we should be shown. And by the way, just telling you that in case if you are making non-corporate accounts, proprietor partnership is the case maybe, and generally we don't make a provision for taxation, or we don't make this provision for deferred tax, okay, then as an auditor we have to qualify the report of non-corporate entity in form number 3CB stating that mandatory accounting standard AS22 has not been followed. Of course, this is a meeting on company law. I should not otherwise be speaking on this, but since it is there as part of it, I am just as a passing reference telling you that be careful on this. Same way, let us say that you are in non-corporate entity, you are following income tax rates for depreciation. Okay. And then you sell the asset or buy the asset as the case may be. Now, when we sell the asset, what we do typically do is entire sale proceeds is credited to the asset account rather than making a profit or loss out of that asset, sale of asset. Okay. Now, this is in contravention of accounting standard 10. And accordingly, we also should be reporting or qualifying in case of a non-corporate entity that the assets are sold, profits or losses are there, but they have not been accounted in the profit and loss statement. And accordingly, this is in contravention of accounting standard 10. This is what, as a passing reference, as a byproduct or as a value addition, whatever you consider, I'm telling you in this meeting, nothing else. Work 34, financial statements, board's report, etc. Financial statements to be approved by the board of directors before submitting to the auditors. We often find that the auditors sign first and then the directors sign. Okay, please don't do this. Very dangerous, very dangerous. Okay, let the company sign, then only you should be signing as an auditor. As simple as that. Come what may, I will not sign. We are supposed to put our foot down. Okay. The statement should be signed by chairman, managing director if there is one, and two directors, otherwise CEO and company secretary if there is one. Auditor's report shall be attached to every financial statements, and director's report should be attached also, which we all know this is very, very old thing. 135 CSR, it's a huge thing. Okay. But I'm just telling you that in case if your net worth is more than 500 crore rupees, or turnover is more than 1000 crore rupees, or net profit is more than 5 crore rupees of immediately preceding previous year. Okay, now this there is a change here from the last year. Earlier it was some other language. Now you have to look at the net profit of immediately preceding financial year. If it exceeds more than 5 crore rupees, then if any of these conditions are hit, then you should go for CSR. And company should spend every financial year at least 2% of the average net profits of the company made during three immediately preceding financial years. That is the average profit of last 3 years. You have to spend 2% on account of CSR. And in case if CSR is not done, there are consequences which I'm not dealing with right now. Be careful on that. And CSR expenditure is not allowable as an expenditure under the Income Tax Act, we all know. But yes, there are certain CSR expenditure which you make, you get deductions under relevant section, or let's say 80G, or as the case may be, in the institute's reference, a list is given as to how you can take the benefit of Income Tax Act while spending the CSR. Okay, there those sections, if you refer to, you may take the benefit of expenditure under CSR as a reduction under the Income Tax Act. 136 is right of members to the copies of account. Every member has a right to copy. Why I have taken this particular section is, in a private limited company, usually we have 3 days notice, or 7 days notice, or 12 days notice as the case may be, rather than 21 days notice, right? Now, if that is the case also, then also the law requires that financial statement, you may give notice before 3 days as per articles, or 7 days as per articles, no worries. Okay, but the financial statements have to reach the members before 21 days. So hum log kya karte hai ki audit ke time pe kya karte hai ki jitna hamara audit lamba khicha, hum log we try to pull the date to such an extent. Let's say I have 3 days notice only to be given for two members. Okay, so let's say I'm signing the balance sheet on 25th. Okay, so I would put 25th, and I will say there are teen din ka hi sawal hai na, to teen din to ho, 25th and 30th mein teen din to ho jate hai. So I will sign the report on 25th of September, and on 30th September I am holding the AGM. That meeting will be treated as invalid, because although the notice could be in time, the financial statements have not been sent to the members before 21 days. That is the law. Okay. So one should be very clear that in this kind of an eventuality happens, abhi aap log bolenge to karne ka kya rasta hai. In case if 95% of the members who are able to vote in the meeting agree that the period of receiving accounts is acceptable to them, which is less than 21 days, then that resolution can be carried through. So for any reason you are not able to sign the balance sheet in time and it is prolonged, in that case please make it sure that you pass a resolution stating that the members are okay with the lesser number of days within which they got the accounts for perusal. Okay, and 14 days is there in case of section 8 company, but this is also very important, which needs to be kept in mind, because we always go with the notion that 3 din ka notice hai na, to 3 din ka notice hai to accounts bhi 3 din pehle sign karo, koi farak nahi padta, but that is not the case, be careful. 137, copy of financial statements to be filed with the registrar, we all know. Within 30 days from the date of AGM, but what we don't know is for any reason the accounts are not audit adopted, then also we should file those accounts, unadopted accounts, with the registrar stating that these accounts are not adopted. If the AGM is not held, then within 30 days from the due date of AGM you have to file. So let us say there is a management dispute and the accounts are not done, then also within 30 days from the date of AGM, that is consider 30th September as the due date of your AGM, then by 30th October you should give unaudited financial statements to the registrar with a specific thing that yes, these accounts are not adopted, not audited because of this reason. But not giving accounts at all to the registrar is again an offense which you one should keep in mind. And as far as OPC, one person company is concerned, the financial statements have to be given within 180 days from the closure of financial years, that is 30th September only they have to file financial statement with the registrar in case if you are auditing any OPC. 138 is internal auditor. Every listed company has to have internal auditor. Every unlisted public company, in case if its share capital is more than 50 crore or turnover more than 200 crore, or outstanding borrowings are more than 100 crores, or outstanding deposits are more than 25 crores, if any of these conditions are complied with or satisfied as the case may be, internal auditor is must. Okay, and every private company who has turnover of more than 200 crore rupees or borrowing more than 100 crore rupees also has to have internal auditor. An internal auditor could be an employee of the company or could be outsider also. He could be a chartered accountant or a cost accountant or any other professional notified under the Companies Act, as the case may be. These are wordings of Act. I'm telling you that he can be any of this person. There is no problem about it. But there are statutory auditor cannot be internal auditor. We all. Now we come to section 143. Now I've given the comparative sections 227(2), 227(3) of the 1956 Act. Because as I said earlier, 2013 Act literally made me illiterate for some time. So I just had to, whenever I want to refer to something, I'll go to the table. Ke Companies Act ka ye section kaun sa hai, uska relevant 2013 ka section kaun sa hai, then I will read it. So this is how I used to, and even today also I'm practicing this way only, honestly. Okay. So 227(2) earlier, now balance sheet, it deals with 143(2) deals with balance sheet and P&L. Additional information is to be given in 143(3). That is, we have obtained all the information, expression which to the best of our knowledge and belief are necessary for the purpose of our audit, and all those A to G clauses are there. Okay. Now qualifications are considered, are taken care of by 143(4). Inquiries which I am dealing with 143(1). Order CARO 2003, which is now CARO 2016. Is 143(11). Fraud reporting and auditing standards now are getting statutory mandate. So auditing standards have to be followed by us as chartered accountants pursuant to section 143(9). Earlier only institute was asking us. Now even the company law is asking us that auditing standards have to be followed by us. Companies Act 139 deals with appointment, 140 deals with removal, resignation, 141 deals with eligibility, qualifications, disqualifications, 142 with remuneration, 143 powers and duties of auditors and accounting standards, 144 auditors not to render certain services, 145 auditor to sign reports, etc. 144 I will just deal, I'm not dealing with it separately, but the CMA report which we used to make earlier, is not no more permissible as an auditor for us. You cannot make CMA data as an auditor of the company. Be careful about it. Auditor to sign audit report, etc. Auditors to attend general meeting. Okay, that is 146. And in case if you are not attending general meeting, because private limited companies, all our clients, we all know that the meeting is always held at 30th September, and all the meetings across the board are at 11 o'clock in the morning. So as an auditor, it is impossible for us to attend all the meetings, we know. Okay, so at least write a letter to the company stating that we will not be able to attend the AGM. Kindly let us know if our attendance is required. Okay. Auditors to it. Then 147 is punishment and contravention, and 148 is basically post records. So now we'll be dealing with 139 very fast. If you are first auditor, then within 30 days from the date of incorporation, board has to appoint. In case if the board is not able to appoint first auditors, then within 90 days, members have to appoint the auditors. This is the law. In case if members don't appoint auditors within 90 days, then what happens? There is no clarification under the law. Okay. Earlier, ROC had the power to appoint. Now that power has been taken away. A subsequent appointment in the first AGM, the auditor has to be appointed for 5 years now, straight away. Okay. And written consent of the auditor has to be taken in the format prescribed, that 1, 2, 3, 4, which are there. I'm not dealing with that, but that consent needs to be given by you, by us as auditors. And the company has to file the form number ADT1 within 15 days from the appointment. Now under the 1956 Act, first auditor ka ADT1 was not required to be filed. But under the Companies Act 2013, even first auditor's ADT1 has to be filed. Be careful on this. No listed company or a company belonging to such classes of, this is with respect to rotation of auditors. I'll be very brief on this. We all know listed companies, basically, in case the auditor is a proprietor, then cannot have more than 5 years as auditor. He has to retire by rotation. And in case if it is a firm of auditors, then maximum 10 years are given to you. So, and then you need to rotate, and there'll be disconnect for more than not less than 5 years. So once you rotate, you are rotated and removed, that means not removed, but retiring as a rotation direct auditor by rotation, then for next 5 years you cannot be reappointed as the auditor. So there is going to be a disconnect of not less than 5 years. Okay. And other companies which are not listed also, in case if you are having paid up capital of more than unlisted public, not private, unlisted public companies having paid up capital of 10 crores or more, or private companies having paid up capital of 50 crores or more, or any of these companies have bank borrowing more than 50 crore rupees, okay, in that case, even they have to appoint the auditors only by rotation. So their auditors have to retire by rotation. One should keep in mind. Casual vacancy, if it occurs because of death of the director, then it can be filled in by the board of directors. Okay, death of the auditor, I'm sorry, not director, death of auditor, then it can be filled by the directors, board of directors. In case if it is owing to resignation, 1956 Act required that vacancy can only be filled by general meeting, but now that is not the case under the new law. In case if resignation is there of an auditor, the board has a power to appoint the new auditor, but within 3 months, his appointment has to be regularized by the general meeting, and he will hold the office for only till the next in conclusion of next annual general meeting, and then he can be appointed for next 5 years. So in case somebody is resigning and you are being appointed by the board of directors or by the company itself, then also you cannot be appointed for 5 years at that point in time, please. You need to hold office only for the first year till next AGM, and in the next AGM, you can then be appointed for next 5 years. This is how the law is framed. 141, disqualifications and qualifications. In case auditor or his relative, the first thing first, auditor or relative cannot hold or own shares of the company of which you are auditor. Okay, but there is a relaxation given that relatives of the auditor can hold shares up to the face value of rupees 1 lakh. There is no problem. And in case for any reason, if that amount exceeds, then within 68 days, the auditor has to correct the mistake. Otherwise, he will have to resign. Okay. Then the auditor or the relative cannot be indebted to the company or subsidiary or holding associate or subsidiary company in excess of 5 lakh. Even earlier also, be careful. Holding of security is not only with respect to company. It's subsidiary holding or associate company or subsidiary of holding company as a case. We know where you should hold shares. Same way, you should not be indebted to any of these companies for more than 5 lakh rupees. Earlier only it was 1000 or 5000 rupees. Now it is 5 lakh rupees. And you cannot give guarantee or provide security, whether you are relative or auditor itself. Your guarantee amount should not exceed 1 lakh rupees. Okay. Otherwise, you are disqualified as an auditor. Then 143, powers and duties of the auditors and accounting standards. Inquiries to be made, which is very important. Now we'll say inquiry kya kya karne ka hai. If you need to make 6 inquiries, and in case if you accept, if you find those inquiries okay, then you don't have to do anything. But in case the result of those inquiries is negative, then you may have to qualify, give adverse report, give disclaimer, give disclosure, as the case may be, but you need to do something. Okay. And every auditor shall comply with the accounting standard that any which way is there. Actually, as per the institute, it is accounting standards have to be complied with by the company. And the auditor has to see whether the accounting standards are complied with or not. But there is an anomaly. Let's not get into that the thing right now. Okay. So as far as inquiries are concerned, first inquiry that you need to make is, are loans and advances made by the company are loans and advances made by the company covered by any security of the parties? If yes, are such loans and advances prejudicial to the interest of company? Number one. Number two, transactions that are represented merely by book entry, have the transactions in fact taken place? Okay, sir, journal entry pass kar diya hai, to ye transactions valid hai ka nahi hai? That you need to consider. If company is not an investment company, if the investment is sold at a loss, then you need to see whether that is the case, what is the reason. Are loans and advances made by the company shown as deposits? This is one particular inquiry you should be very, very careful about. Company ne kisi ko loan diya hai, but that loan amount cannot be shown. So it shows it as a deposit. Deposit given, then you have to qualify that. Okay. Are personal expenses of directors, employees charged to revenue and in respect of shares allotted for cash, has actually the cash been received? Position stated in the balance sheet is correct and not misleading. Now, here I will just point it out. Let's say a director's loan is converted into equity. Should it be considered as allotment for cash or not is an issue. The institute stand is that it is not, since loan is converted into equity, it is not a cash transaction, and accordingly that cannot be considered or treated as a loan shares allotted for cash. But the Department of Company Affairs, before this MCA had come, it was DCA, Department of Company Affairs. Uska clarification hai, in case if the loans are converted into equity, and actually those loans were given by way of cash or check, as the case may be, such kind of a conversion of loan into equity can be treated as shares allotted for cash. Okay, but be it as may be, that I'm not touching the controversy right now, who's right, who's wrong, but these inquiries have to be made and they have to be kept on record that these inquiries are made by us being auditors. Okay, just If you have not recorded these inquiries, your audit working paper are that to that extent faulty, I would say. Be careful. Now, since accounting auditing standards have to be followed by the auditor, okay, these are the stand list. This is a list of standards on auditing. 100 to 199 is introductory, 200 to 299 general principles, 300, 399 and so on and so forth. I would just touch upon the auditing standards, which are very, very important. SA 200, which is with respect to financial statements, are free from misstatement. Now see, why I'm telling all these things is that somewhere the other, we are fantastic at doing audit. We all, I'm telling you, friends. But the lacking on our part is documentation. हमने ऑडिट किया है, वो डॉक्टर होता है ना, वो ऑपरेशन करेगा ना, तो उसका कट करेगा ना इधर से कहीं, तो कट दिखेगा तो पता चलेगा कि ये ऑपरेशन हुआ, ओके. लेकिन हमने ऑडिट किया तो ऐसा कोई कट है ही नहीं हमारे पास, देन हाउ वुड वी प्रूव दैट द ऑडिट इज डन, ओके. सेम वे इन केस इफ आई एम फॉलोइंग ऑडिटिंग स्टैंडर्ड्स, आई एम एंश्योरिंग दैट द फाइनेंशियल स्टेटमेंट्स आर फ्री फ्रॉम मिसस्टेटमेंट, बट हैव आई डॉक्यूमेंटेड दोस थिंग्स. This is where we are lacking, and we need to actually gear up on these aspects. Okay, so that is SA 200. SA 210 is agreeing to the terms of audit engagements. 220 is he has to remain alert. He has to maintain his independence. Reviews and SQC 1 has to be followed. SQC 1 is important because then only you can be given the peer review certificate, not otherwise. SA 230 is audit documentation. You know, we see, at least I would say these standards are very big. It is practically not possible for a person, means the person who is practicing at the medium sized level, to read all these financial, all these auditing standards. Although we must read, there is no excuse to that. Okay, but at least we must know something of it. Certain part of it we should. Important, they are made in bold and italics. Okay, just read those paragraphs and make it sure that some portion of it is account is made as part of the documentation in file, so that we can prove tomorrow that auditing standards are actually followed by us. Okay, so 230 is audit documentation, 240 is auditor's responsibility relating to fraud and fraud in audit of financial statements. Then 250 revised is consideration of laws and regulations in audit of financial statements. Now this COVID, okay, no, none of us have actually been able to do anything as of 31st March, right? We have not been able to go for stock taking. We have not been able to go for cash counting, okay, because a law was in force that you cannot go out. It was a lockdown, okay. Then how would you deal with this? Okay, because now you cannot say that I have verified the stocks. You cannot say that I have verified the cash. Okay, so these are the laws, separate laws which are there with of course pollution control. Okay, those or other laws which are affecting otherwise your entire entity, they need to be considered as auditor whether the concern remains a going concern or not. That is the main thing. 260 is communication with those charged with the governance. हम लोग क्या करते हैं, ऑडिट कर लेंगे बाद में लास्ट में जाएंगे कि इतना इतना क्वेरीज है, दैट इज नॉट परमिसिबल. एज द ऑडिट प्रोग्रेसेस वी शुड इन्फॉर्म द मैनेजमेंट दैट दिस आर द इश्यूज, दिस आर द फाइंडिंग्स एंड यू हैव टू कम्युनिकेट ऑन अ रेगुलर बेसिस. कम्युनिकेशन कम्युनिकेटेड डेफिशिएंसीज इन इंटरनल कंट्रोल, दोज चार्ज विद द गवर्नेंस, वो भी आपको करना है. रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी ऑफ जॉइंट ऑडिटर्स, planning audit statements, identifying assessing the risk of material misstatement, and 320 is analytical review. हम लोग बच्चे लोग को बोलते हैं कि ऑडिट करना करके आओ सर, क्या करने का है, एक काम करना वाउचिंग करना सर, वाउचिंग में क्या करने का है, एक काम करना परचेज वाउचिंग सर, परचेज वाउचिंग में क्या करूँ, तो एक काम करना जो भी परचेज वाउचर 10,000 रुपए के ऊपर है ना वो चेक कर लेना, ओके. जो भी एक्सपेंस वाउचर है वो अगर 1,000 रुपए के ऊपर है तो वो चेक कर लेना, ओके. और दिस इज हाउ वी इंस्ट्रक्ट द स्टाफ एंड दे गो फॉर ऑडिट. नाउ दिस इज नो मोर परमिसिबल. यू हैव टू गो फॉर एनालिटिकल रिव्यू, दैट इज स्टेटिस्टिकल सैंपलिंग टेक्निक. देयर इज अ टेक्निक गिवन एंड बेस्ड ऑन दैट टेक्निक ओनली यू शुड से दैट दिस इज द साइज ऑफ सैंपल आई एम पिकिंग अप. So just to give an example, let's say total sale is 5 crore rupees and total bills are let's say 1,000. Okay, so 4 crore divided by 1,000, whatever the figure comes, uska derivation karke you have to pick up the random numbers, the statistical numbers, and those particular vouchers are to be vouched by us on a statistical sampling technique. ओके सो यू जस्ट कैन नॉट से दैट 500 रुपए का 1000 रुपए का 10000 रुपए के ऊपर का वाउचर सिलेक्ट करो दोस डेज ऑफ बोन ओके ऐसे 402 इज ऑडिट कंसीडरेशन यूजिंग इफ यू आर यूजिंग अनदर एंटिटी सर्विस अदर सर्विस ऑर्गेनाइजेशन ओके तो उसके लिए ऐसे 402 है एंड मिसस्टेटमेंट्स है तो 450 है 500 is audit evidence, 505 is external confirmation, very important, please be careful, please ask for certain external confirmation, direct confirmation from the debtors, creditors as the case may be and keep it on file. 510 revise is initial audit engagement opening balances, 520 is analytical procedures, 530 is audit sampling, 570 is going concern. Now, CARO does not require us to report on going concern, but still we have to see whether the company is a going concern or not. 580 is written representation, that is management representation letter. 600 using work of another auditor, using work of internal auditor, using work of auditor's expert. Okay, like I consulted some advocate for a particular thing. Uske sab ke liye standard hai. Okay, so we need to at least document certain things that we have followed these auditing standards because if you read the audit report that we are signing, no, udhar hum log likh rahe hai that yes, we have followed auditing standards prescribed by the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. And then if you don't have a single paper to show that I have followed the auditing standards, how will you stand? Okay, this is the thing. 700 to 799 audit conclusion reporting applicable from 1/4/2014 unmodified these are the audit reports formats which are given which have changed from last year so these are SS 700 to 799 emphasis of matter then 706 other matters paragraph 706 modification hai to adverse qualified then 705 okay SS 705 So this is the list of all those standards which we actually dealt with. So I'm skipping the slides. ये ज़्यादा detail में है, but मैंने क्या किया कि पिछले slides में जो था ना, I've also given explanation here. That's the reason I was marked them separately. These slides are already dealt with, so we'll skip these slides. Now some we have around 12 minutes by now. And I'll try to finish off within 15 minutes or maximum 20 minutes. I think 15 minutes should be more than enough. Section 73 is, these are other important sections concerning audit, okay, which we should keep in mind while auditing the books. Section 73 deals with deposits. Now the law of earlier the law was very stringent now the law has been relaxed substantially for private companies directors and relatives can give any amount there is no problem you can accept from shareholders maximum 100 up to 100% of your paid up capital and reserves not more than that earlier what used to happen ke shareholder hai na uske paas se jitna bhi paisa chahiye tha hum log le sakte the so we used to make a person shareholder by giving one share And then we used to take crores of rupees from them. Now that is not permissible. So from shareholders, what you can ask is only 100% of your paid up capital and reserves maximum. Okay. From directors and relatives, any amount. Okay. That is basically section 73. Of course, section 73 is a huge thing, but mota moti 73 ka ye crux hai, which you should keep in mind. 135 CSR we already dealt with. 185 loans to directors. This section has also been amended and diluted from 2017. I'm dealing with this, but the sum and substance of it is in case if a loan is to be given to the director or the relatives of the director or the concerns where the director is interested, then a special resolution is to be passed. Okay. Section 185 is not applicable to a private company in certain circumstances, which I am coming to. But earlier there was a government approval, which has now been done away with. If you pass a resolution, that should be good enough. 186 is limit for intercompany investment and loans. See, up to 60% of your paid up capital and reserve, you can give loans or invest into shares of another company, there is no problem about it. So exemptions which are given to private companies from 185 by this notification dated 5th June 2015, what it says is that in case of a private company, section 185 shall not apply if in whose share capital no other body corporate has invested any money. So आपका जो प्राइवेट कंपनी है उसमें कोई बॉडी कॉर्पोरेट शेयर होल्डर नहीं है. ओके, बॉडी कॉर्पोरेट ऑल्सो इंक्लूड्स एलएलपी, माइंड यू, माइंड वेल. ओके, तो इफ अनदर कंपनी और अनदर एलएलपी एज द केस में बी आर नॉट योर शेयर होल्डर्स, देन इफ द बोरोइंग्स ऑफ सच कंपनी फ्रॉम बैंक्स और इंस्टीट्यूशंस इज लेस देन ट्वाइस ऑफ इट्स पेड अप कैपिटल ओवर 50 करोड़ रुपीज व्हिच एवर इज लेस, and such company has no default in making repayment of borrowings at the time of at the time of making transaction, then 185 would not be applicable to a private company. Okay, otherwise 185 will hit the private companies also. Okay, so be careful on this. Then 187 is investment of company to be held in own name. Main bola tha na, I am missing on the section 49 of 1956 act. Now it has become 187 of the Companies Act 2013. In case a company is holding investments but it is not in its own name but it is in name of directors, as the case may be, under certain circumstances, typical I would say there is a 100% holder subsidiary for me, okay, which I am owning, but it's a private company, let us say. Okay, now technically I am holding 100% capital, but there has to be two members for sure. So there will have to have one other person who should be the shareholder. Here it is provided that fine, if this is the position, then it is acceptable. Okay, so 49 and 187 of this 2013 act. Of course there are other exceptions also, but you should keep this in mind of 187 also while auditing the books of account of a company. Then 177 is audit committee, and 188 is related party. 177, if you are not an auditor of a listed company, 177 may not apply to you, but 188 related party transactions applies to us. So be careful, at least read it once, along with accounting standard 18. वो दोनों को match करना है, okay? Then 189 is register of contracts or arrangements in which directors are interested. Companies Act 1956, 301 register, if you remember. 301 register now is 189 register. Okay. 192, restriction on non-cash transactions involving directors. So let us say that the directors are having some transactions which are not in nature of cash transactions. Let us say the directors are buying shares of a company by selling the properties to the company. Okay, this is nothing but a non-cash transaction, and if it is a non-cash transaction, how do you deal with it? 192. Okay, I'm not dealing with each and every section, my dear friends. I know where we have limitation of time, okay, but at least you may keep these sections in mind while auditing the books of account of a company. 197, overall max managerial remuneration. And managerial remuneration in case of absence of or inadequacy of profit. Of course, 197 is not applicable to a private company, you don't have to worry about. But if it is a public company, then 197 is applicable. 198, how do you calculate your profits for the purpose of 197? Then the depreciation has to be provided as per Schedule 2 to the Companies Act 2013. You have to determine the useful life of asset, and you have to then work out the residual value of like probable residual value of that asset. Okay, so residuary life cannot be more than 5%. So I would just say that let's say the asset is bought for 100 rupees. Okay, and then at the best, what you can say is 5 rupees can be the realizable value. So 95 divided by the number of years for which the asset will last according to you. Okay, this is how you should be calculating depreciation. We have made a depreciation utility. I have shared this in past. In case if somebody wants, I can always share this utility. How do you calculate depreciation? Okay. 188 is related party transaction. 77 is registration of charge, and 3129 CFS we already dealt with. This particular slide we already dealt with. CF consolidated financial statement. I'm skipping this. So last part we have reached is the Caro. Earlier we had Mao Caro 75, then 88, 2003, 15, 16, 20, but 2020 is deferred. So as of today, for financial year 19-20, we have to follow 2016 Caro. Okay. So I will just pick up certain aspects of Caro. We have only 4 minutes left as the at the moment, and I think we have some questions also. Bhavan Bhai has, I think, given. I'll try to deal with
Rahul Bhai. Yeah. Rahul Bhai, you can take another 5-10 minutes, no issue, and afterwards you can take questions. You can take another 5-10 minutes for your presentation.
Okay, Bhavan Bhai. So I'm not dealing with everything now, but Caro aspects I will just see that Caro is not applicable. Caro is applicable to every company, including foreign company. It does not apply to banking, insurance, and private Section 8 companies. It is not applicable to private company and one person, the OPC also. Okay. And of course, a private company not being a subsidiary of a public company, or who does not have paid up capital or reserve more than 1 crore rupees on the balance sheet date, or loans more than 1 crore rupees, or revenues of 10 crore rupees. In case if you have all these things less than the prescribed limit, then the Caro would not be applicable to you. But be careful, please document this. If the Caro is not applied by you, then please document as to how Caro is not applied. Okay. Now there are some FAQs also, whether bonus shares are covered. Why bonus shares covered? In the sense, I have to pick up the paid up capital and reserve. Okay. So if bonus are covered, bonus are issued, then the reserves would come down and the share capital will go up. Accordingly, it will not have any implication on the Caro. So these are the FAQs, whether I should be considering bonus for applicability of Caro. Okay. Whether share issued for consideration other than cash covered, yes, covered. Whether revaluation reserve is to be considered, yes. Even revaluation reserve is to be considered. Whether capital reserve is to be covered, yes, it is to be covered. Whether special reserve, all types of reserves have to be considered for the purpose of applicability of Caro. So once you cross 1 crore limit, then Caro would be applied. Whether government companies are covered, I am just taking a few FAQs. In fact, you can have entire meeting on Caro. And where there we can have these questions, but I'll just touch upon very, very crucial aspects. Balance of loans. In case when should I consider the bank balance? Let's means bank balance, nahi, loan. Let's say I have a 10 crore ka limit, right? Let's say I have a credit facility from bank, and during a year, my limit is always 9 crore 75 lakh rupees. Okay. It is not exceeding 10 crore rupees, but for one day, it has exceeded 10 crore rupees. Moment it is exceeding 10 crore rupees for one day also, then it will, Caro would be applicable. Okay, this is how one should read it. Yeah, comments on non-applicability of Caro. Yeah. In case if Caro is not applicable, then you please put this particular note that this report does not include a statement on the matter specified in paragraph 3 of the company's auditor's report 2016. This is very important. Same way, let us say that you are a small company and you have not given cash flow statement. Please mention in your auditor's report that the cash flow statement is not given because the company is a small company. I missed that to tell you earlier. So be careful on this, please. Whether one or two. Yeah, in case if management explanation should be considered by you while reporting, yes, you can consider the management's explanation also. this documentation, we already dealt with it. It is very essential. Both unless and until we have documented the things properly, we cannot prove ourselves innocent. That is what the scene is very, 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 very scary. I'm telling you, it's horror scene. Okay, so please make it a point कि आपके पास पर्स में जितना नोट्स है ना उससे ज्यादा आपका डॉक्यूमेंटेशन होना चाहिए. As simple as that. Okay, so now let us take the questions. I'll just refer to Bhavin Bhai has given some questions. I'll just read them.
Yeah, sir, these questions members has given in the chat window that I posted on your WhatsApp, sir.
Oh yeah, so first question that has been raised is whether indirect tax to be included for calculation of turnover even if we follow exclusive method of accounting. The answer is no. Indirect taxes are not to be included for the purpose of turnover. I did not take that indirect taxation position, but now the position is very clear. Although your 145A of the Income Tax Act requires to include your turnover for the permits, include your indirect taxes as part of your turnover, yet you don't have to consider indirect taxation for the purpose of carve-out. Okay. I think this question is for with respect to carve-out only. Huh? This is what I understand. Whether the question is whether indirect tax to be included for calculation of turnover, even if we follow exclusive method of accounting, you don't have to consider. If you follow inclusive method of accounting, then yes, then you have to follow. You have to consider that as a part of your turnover, not otherwise. Second question is foreign currency translation reserve a part of net worth? Foreign currency translation reserve, if it is merely an entry, I would say, okay, it is actually, I would say it is not the language was, I'll just, language is, we'll have to go to that particular slide, just a minute. Yeah. If it is unrealized gain or loss, as the case may be, see, be careful. Implication of unrealized gains. Okay. So in case, ये सवाल क्या है? नेटवर्थ पे है कि किस पे है? हाँ, अच्छा, नेटवर्थ है तो नेटवर्थ में, yes, नेटवर्थ में it will be considered as part of the नेटवर्थ. Okay. But for free reserve purposes, it will not be considered. For net worth, it will be considered. I'm sorry, I missed it. Okay, so I repeat, for calculation of net worth, foreign currency translation reserve will be part of the net worth. But for considering it as a free reserve, you will not consider it because it is not a not unrealized gain or loss, as the case may be. But it is not realized gain or loss. The next is, under which section of Companies Act audit is conducted? For example, Income Tax Act is 44AB. The answer is 143 is the section. 139 you are appointed, and 143 is the act. This is the section under which you are doing, because powers and duties of auditor are given under section 143. So the question is, under which section of Companies Act audit is conducted? For example, Income Tax Act 44AB. Section 143 of the Companies Act 2013 is the section under which you are doing the audit. Next issue is, a company does not violate under a company does not violation under any law which pertains to non-filing of returns or documents, then is reporting required in notes to financial statement or audit report, and whether qualification is warranted or not? I'm not getting this issue. Company does not, as a company does violation under any law. Okay, understood. Sorry. Company does violation under any law which pertains to non-filing of returns or documents, then is reporting required in notes to financial statements or audit report, and whether qualification is warranted or not. Now I'll just tell you, link this with particularly existence of the company, going concern concept of the company. If the violation is such that the entire company can be put to closure, let's say you are an industry and you have not followed the pollution control procedure or fire department's instructions which are there, that aapke paas ye darwaza hona chahiye, wo darwaza hona chahiye, and because of that your entire unit can be shut down. If this kind of a gravity is there, that the company may exist, company may not exist, then it is a problem of going concern. From that angle, you may have to qualify or give disclosure, or as the case may be, of the thing. But let us say आपने GST का return भरा नहीं है, okay? तो GST का return भरा नहीं है, does it mandate you to qualify the report? To my mind, is it endangering your going concern concept? If yes, qualify. If no, don't qualify. So this is how one should understand that. Because I am not supposed to look at every law. There are hundreds of laws, okay? But what I'm supposed to see is that if a particular law is there, which is, if violated, can endanger the going concern or existence of the company itself, then I must report. This is how one should read it. Then Bhavin Bhai has further stated, these questions were related to small company calculation, which you have presented in sharing, starting, whether indirect taxes to be. Yeah, small company ke liye bhi aapko ye jo first tha na, whether indirect taxes are to be included for calculation of turnover, there also for small companies this indirect taxes have to be excluded, not to be included. It is very clear, okay? But in case if you are following inclusive method of accounting, inclusive method of accounting means what? Ke aap 100 rupees ka maal bechte ho generally, okay? Uske upar 118 rupees ka GST hai, to aap 118 karoge, so 100 plus 18, that is 100 plus 9 plus 9, CGST, SGST, okay? So 118. But let us say inclusive method kya karenge aap? Aisa nahi hai ki aapne 100 rupees plus 18 rupees jod diya hai. Inclusive method should be read it this way, that you are billing the client of 118 rupees only, so you are not passing on the GST credit to him. That is fundamentally the inclusive method of accounting one should understand. Of course, another view is also possible. 100 mein mera profit and loss account mein jitna bhi sale hai usme main GST add kar dunga, wo bhi inclusive method hi hai. I agree, that is also a possible view. But technically speaking, inclusive method means that you are not charging GST separately, or you are not charging indirect taxes separately. That is fundamentally the inclusive method, but other view is also possible. But any which ways, in case if you are following exclusive method of accounting, then for calculating that, say, small company thing, you don't have to consider indirect taxes for sure. Then another issue is whether any disclosure is required on accounts of COVID in this year's financial statements account. Even I have to understand this thing. Let's wait for the institute to say something. Institute, in fact, has given some guidance. I have not read it, honestly. But under COVID principles, I'll just share with the conveners, and then conveners can email it to you. And of course, then it will be an opportunity for me also to read it. But yes, institute has already come out with the guidance on this, as to how do you deal with this COVID thing. Okay, so I'll just put it this way. I'll keep you posted on this. Bhavin Bhai, Charvik, any other questions?
No, sir. No, okay. Other questions, sir.
Fine. So we have almost we come to end of our presentation. It is indeed a pleasure for you all. In fact, I really don't know who all are watching me or seeing this presentation, but I'm really glad and I'm honored and indebted to you all for giving this fantastic opportunity to share my views on provisions concerning Companies Act on audit. So thank you so much, you all. In case if I have not been able to come up to your expectations, I have spoken something which you did not like, or you want, I have not spoken which you wanted me to speak, I'm sorry. Please forgive me. I love you all. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Mehul bhai.
Yeah. Yes.
Hello. Sir. Just one more question came. I just WhatsApp you. Just yeah, one yeah, question yeah. is can you?
Yeah, you sent it, is it? Okay.
Yeah, WhatsApp.
Nahi, Ajay, abhi nahi bhai mana.
Okay, I will doubt. If COVID-19 impact, if COVID-19 impact.
I'll just read it. I wrote it. If COVID-19 impact to continue for 6 to 9 months, then hotel companies and tours and traveling companies may not have comparative business to last year. In that case, how going concern to deal with? See, it is an exceptional situation, my friends. Okay, so government is sure enough going to support all these entities. So at least for this particular year, I don't think there is any going to be issue of going concern. But yes, for any reason, the company itself is closing down right now. Let us say that you are auditing the books of account of that company in September. And by June or July, as the case may be, company has decided to wind up. Okay. In that case, you may have to consider the COVID impact and you may have to say state that the company is no more a going concern. But let us say that the implication, we pray God that this ends in next 3-4 days, maximum 10 days. Okay, and we all join our work by 3rd of May, or if I would say 1st of May is the right time, I would just go and start working. This is my prayer. But God forbid, in case if this impact continues for a long period of time also, then one should not be treating anybody as a not going concern unless and until company has virtually closed up. Because these are exceptional circumstances. Nobody has thought of all these things. So I'm sure Institute will also come with some guidance on this. But as it stands today, I don't think one should actually go and say that, oh, company may not remain a going concern. That cannot be, let us not be so harsh. Because the way they are facing problems, even we are facing problems. Imagine that tomorrow, if all our clients are the wound up, what will happen to us? Can you imagine this situation? Will we remain a going concern? So, log kya karenge? Arre, hum log dusra kuch kaam kar lenge, na? So the same way, even the client may do something or the other. Everybody has to survive in this country. Okay. So let us wait and watch for this. And pray God that everything goes. Sarve na sukhina santu, sarve santu niramaya, sarve badrani pashyantu, ma kaschid dukha bhaga bhaga. So this is what the prayer we actually make to Almighty God, that everybody should be happy, everybody should be sukhi. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Before we end, some announcements. We are planning for some more sessions in coming week, 2 or 3 sessions. In the next week, the announcement will be made through emails or by WhatsApp to all. Hope you all are enjoying learning. Now I request Mamta Madam to take vote of thanks. Thank you, Mehul.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mehul sir, for your insightful presentation on Companies Act, specifically giving knowledge on accounting standard will prevail over Companies Act, notice calling AGM, on time is not enough, even financial statement should be given on time, appointment of first auditor, appointment of auditor in case of death, etc. is a knowledge which you have provided. There is one Japanese proverb that has been given that better than 1,000 days of diligent study is 1 day with an expert speaker. So this was what we have felt after listening to you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you so much all. Thanks.
Thank you. We are closing now. Thank you.